Hi folks, I'm Matt and welcome to My Expanded Universe, a show where I go through the entire EU in chronological order as best I know how. Folks, we're going to talk about a novel. Again, yay, I get to talk about novels here. And this is a novel written by James Luceno. It's called Millennium Falcon. And basically, it's giving the Falcon's origin. It's a little buffer story between the Legacy of the Force books and the Fate of the Jedi books. Because Paul S. Kemp's duology had nothing really to do with those. It didn't propel the storyline anywhere. So that's what James Luceno was hired to do with Millennium Falcon. Now, this is kind of interesting because it starts off in the past. If you recall, in the prequels, we saw what looked to be the Millennium Falcon. Well, now we know what it was. It was actually the Stellar Envoy, one of the finest ships to come out of the Corellian shipyards. And they talk about its being built, its origin. It started off as a Stellar Envoy, and there were these two people who were, loyal to the Republic, and they knew at this time, this is right around episode 3, that Palpatine was getting a little too much power, and they said, you know what, we need to go ahead and put a stop to this guy. So what they went on a mission to retrieve some sort of treasure that's supposed to bolster the resistance against Palpatine and end his reign. Well, Palpatine gets wind of this mission, and of course he puts a stop to it. The ship ends up crashing, and that's where we then a crime boss picks up the wreckage of the Stellar Envoy, and he fixes it up and calls it the Second Chance. So now we're seeing some of the origins and steps about how the Falcon came to be. Flash forward to the future, and Alana, the granddaughter of Han and Leia, who's living with them under the guise of being a war orphan, is snooping around the Falcon, and she comes across a transponder that's been located deep within the Falcon from the Clone Wars era. And she shows it to Han, who goes, oh, that's weird. You know what? I've never thought about the, Falcon's history. Maybe we should go on a little adventure and find out its origins. You know, and that's what the Millennium Falcon book is all about. It's about the Millennium Falcon, right? It's history. So he decides to go embark on this mission to do a, you know, what's it called? Heritage Tree, Me-23, whatever it is. To seek out the story of the Millennium Falcon. Now, one thing I got a nitpick on here is I just don't believe that Alana would find something that Han didn't know about on the Falcon. To me, he loves that Falcon, and he has looked at it and taken it apart lovingly, piece by piece over the years. True, a little transponder may escape his view, and I guess I can buy it, but at the same time, I just feel that Han Solo just poured over every nut and bolt across the Falcon, and nothing should come as a surprise to him, especially something that he's had the Falcon for decades at this point, and he's never seen this transponder before. I mean, he's the king of finding things like that on the ship. So I'm just a little bit confused on why he's never noticed this before, but that's not the point. We need a MacGuffin to send him on his merry way to do this quest, right? So it starts moving back through the past. The first stop, Lando. Yay, Lando's in this. But most importantly, his son is in this. The first appearance to welcome Chance Calrissian. Now, he's just like a little kid at this point, but Chance Calrissian is mentioned. Now, you better believe I was interested to see Chance grow up and start being one of the main characters in the series, right? His dad's too old to fight, but Chance is ready and willing for some adventure. He may be a ladies' man, too. Who knows? Watch out, Alana Solo. Chance Calrissian is coming your way. That's right. I was a Chase Alana fan. No, I'm just making that up. Anyway, Lando gives his origin, because remember, Han won the Falcon from Lando, who said, no, I won it from a guy called Kix Truvee, and Kix, they tracked down this Six or Tricks to it's C-I-X, however pronounce that. Kix tells them that, no, I won it from this guy who used to run a circus together. And so we're still trying to backtrack and find whatever happened to the Millennium Falcon. You know, it's total from its point of origin to how it got to Han. Meanwhile, the co-pilot of the Stellar Envoy has woken up from a 62-year coma.
Huh?
Yeah, so he's like a decrepit old man now. He survived the wreck, even though the other, his co-pilot did not. He survived the wreck, and he's alive. He's been in a coma this whole time. Who has put him up to this? Someone called Tob Jabbok, who I guess is just as equally as old, because he's holding out to find out what was that secret treasure they were looking for. I want to be rich too. If he knows the location, maybe I'll... And he's secretly been keeping him on machines to keep him alive, to see if he'll wake up, to see if he'll find this treasure for him. Again, this feels like a little... I'm not trying to nitpick James Luceno here, because I like this book, and I like James Luceno. That seems a little far-fetched. Would you really keep this guy on life support for 62 years for a treasure he may or may not remember when he wakes up? I don't know, man. And what if someone already found it? I don't know. But anyway, that's the story. So the co-pilot wakes up, remembers his mission, and goes off to continue it, even though it doesn't matter at this point. So going back to the Falcon, we do find out that this owner bought it from the previous owner we talked about. We finally figure out how the Falcon came to be the Millennium Falcon. It was from the rebellion days, early rebellion days, you know, between episode 3 and 4, where there was a rebel who had gotten the ship from the crime boss, who called it the Second Chance, and he renamed it the Millennium Falcon. Ah, that's how he got his name. His name is Quip, by the way. And Quip was going on a rebel mission. But if he found out, he would have to, you know, sacrifice the Millennium Falcon. And he loved the ship so much, he decided to abandon his mission, retire, and then sail the ship off eventually. I don't mean to nitpick, but I gotta do it again. So this guy, who's, you know, dedicated to the rebellion and wants to do what's good, can't force himself to destroy a ship that he's owned for, I mean, give it for a few years, but has he really grown that close to him? Is it really that beloved a ship? He bought it from someone else and rebuilt it. I don't know. Again, it could have been better. If it's with the Millennium Falcon, I expected just a little better history. You know, this seemed kind of cobbled together, you know, chintzy here and there. I mean, what were you to do? But at the same time, I just don't like some of these stories. I think some of them were a far stretch. Oh, and by the way, a weak part about this is they finally find the treasure. It's a Republic seal, but a Republic seal that carries a lot of weight. And they were going to use this Republic seal as this old seal of power, as a rallying point for people to rise up against Chancellor Palpatine. Oh, on top of that, the seal ends up being fake. So there's that. And you're thinking, what was the whole purpose of this? Was it to tell the story of the Millennium Falcon, but we figured we had to throw an adventure in there too? Nothing feels well thought out here. Now, believe it or not, I do have someone who told me this was the very first book that they got into. This is what got them into the EU. I'm like, what? What they did is they saw a book with the cover of the Millennium Falcon on, went, ooh, Millennium Falcon? I've always wanted to know about the Millennium Falcon. So yeah, kudos to them. It brought new people into the EU, because who wouldn't want to know the history of the Millennium Falcon? But I think the story would have been better if it just would have been about the Millennium Falcon and not all this other malarkey either. I understand you have to make some kind of excitement, right? Some sort of conclusion, some sort of arc. But just going back and learning about the history of the Falcon would have been good. But at the same time, when I found out about the history, I didn't really much care for it. Now, I should mention at the end of this book, it kind of sets up what's going to happen in Fate of the Jedi. Supposedly, Dala is added again. She and the Jedi have created this big rift. She doesn't really trust the Jedi. She thinks the Jedi aren't pulling their weight. They should be doing things. They're kind of doing their own thing. She doesn't like that. And like Dala, she makes an epic mistake here by issuing a warrant of arrest for Luke Skywalker. And that's where the story ends. Han and Leia are like, oh, we need to get back. Something's happened. You know, Dala has issued a warrant for Luke's arrest or whatever. She's filing charges against him. We're like, whoa. And that's going to, we knew Fate of the Jedi was coming out. So I knew it was going to, you know, continue on that story. But that's basically how they end the story there. Now, originally, this book was conceived as a book of short stories about the Millennium Falcon, you know, giving like little adventures that everyone has had, each of the previous owners have had with the Millennium Falcon, and maybe how they lost it or how it got, you know, put into the other owner's arms and then made it all the way to Han, who is retiring the Falcon. The Falcon's on its last legs, it's not going to make it anymore, and he decides it's finally time to put the old bird to rest and find another vehicle. Now, this would have made an excellent story. No one wants to see the Millennium Falcon, you know, retire, but I'm glad they're not going to blow it up either. That's fun, too. It's not like Han's final ride in the Millennium Falcon, but in a way it was. The original concept was he had decided it was time to retire the Falcon because she's just too old and can't go on anymore. So then it just flashes back with a bunch of stories, and maybe I could even conceive this, maybe even ends of where she's rolling out on the Carillion shipyards and someone goes, that's a fine ship. It's going to make someone very happy one day. You know, I don't know. Maybe Han reminiscing some stories about him and Chewie too and the Falcon. I like that idea. I wish they would have gone for that concept than what they did. Again, I don't mind that this is a bridge book in between two series, but just make it about the Falcon. You didn't have to bridge anything between the gaps between the two epic series going on at the time. And James Luceno, as an author, this would have probably been right up his alley. You don't have to have, it wasn't supposed to be a big adventure, just some mini adventures of people enjoying their time in the Falcon before it finally gets put to rest. Now, probably it would have angered fans, obviously, because what's Han Solo going to fly now? A new vehicle? He can't, there's no Han Solo without the Millennium Falcon. I guess, but I would have been fine with that. I would have been fine if we never saw the Millennium Falcon after that. Like he retired it and that was it. Or maybe it, you know, gets melted down to scrap or something. Or, you know, something happens where, you know, Han just has to let it go. I'm okay with that. The story we got, I thought was subpar. It's not Luceno's worst, but it's definitely not the best. And I was really shocked that this was someone's intro to the EU. Thank goodness he decided to stay. All right, folks, that is all the time I have for now. See you later with another video.